Over the centuries, ever more sophisticated hand weapons have been developed to enhance the efficiency of the individual soldier in battle. Amongst them all, one has risen to an unassailable position of fame, as synonymous with war as death itself. Often, the one element that decided between life and death. Every soldier treated this weapon with the utmost respect and great care. This is the story of the rifle. The first primitive handguns made their clumsy appearance in 1391. The handgon consisted of a short iron or bronze tube mounted on a long wooden post with a touch hole for ignition. Unsurprisingly, its appearance on the front lines did little to influence the course of a battle. It was front-loaded, with the gunpowder being packed through the muzzle, and a stone or iron projectile pushed in after that. Cumbersome and dangerous to fire, it had to be propped up on a wooden post, braced against the chest with one hand, with the other hand putting a lighted match or burning wood chip to the touch hole.
It's a firearm, very simplistic, as a piece of artillery handheld weaponry. It didn't fire projectiles that were purpose-made as much as it did anything that fitted down the barrel that could be fired at the enemy itself. And this was regarded as arrows, stones, gravel, as well as the projectiles that were initially made for it.
The biggest drawback of the early guns was that you ignited it with a piece of glowing hot wire pushed into a hole in the barrel, which didn't make it a very effective weapon for use on a battleground, because you needed a bit of hot wire. And also it meant that you had to look what you were doing when you put the wire into the touch hole, which meant you couldn't look at what you were shooting at.
The potential of this new technology was obvious, and the first advance came with the development of the flash pan. The touch hole was moved to the side of the barrel and a covered cup was attached at the opening. The cup had a protective lid that could be opened and held a small amount of gunpowder inside that could be easily ignited. This, in turn, would go through the hole and ignite the powder in the barrel. Despite its early drawbacks, the development of the handheld gun was having a dynamic effect in battle, and the results were felt amongst a group of the proudest warriors of the Middle Ages. Guns brought about the rapid demise of the era of the medieval knight.
What eventually happened is the gun outpaced the longbow in terms of penetration. And it spelt the end of the armoured knight, because you couldn't build armour thick enough to resist the force of a round projectile fired from a cannon or a handgun.
In the mid-15th century came a breakthrough with the development of the matchlock ignition system. Also known as a harquebus, its improved efficiency helped it to gain wide acceptance amongst armies throughout Europe. It was, however, a short-range weapon and extremely difficult to handle. The matchlock secured a lighted fuse in a curved iron movable arm, so that when the trigger was pulled, it was brought down into the flash pan, igniting the powder. This allowed the user to concentrate on the job of aiming at the target, which was a distinct improvement, but still had a number of disadvantages. Firstly, the time it took to ignite the wick. Secondly, in damp weather, the wicks were still difficult to light and prone to going out. Thirdly, the constantly burning fuse betrayed the soldier's position when used at night.
They were slow firing and they were inaccurate. They probably had a big psychological impact, certainly in their first use. It took time to develop tactics to use these things. But certainly, again, by the 14th and 15th centuries, you're finding men organized in groups, holding handguns to their shoulders and firing at the opposition.
From now on, these guns were to begin their domination of the battlefields of the world. In 1455, they were to demonstrate their increasing importance as the English Wars of the Roses geared up for a conflict of gunfire that endured for over 30 years. Soon, the conflicts of the 15th and 16th centuries were shrouded, quite literally, in the fog of war. Once burnt, the black gunpowder gave off a dense smoke that would hang in the air on damp days and obscure the line of fire. This problem had not been solved even during the English Civil War, when a Royalist captain remarked,
"On which side of this stand of pikes our horse were, I could not discover, for the air was so darkened by the smoke of the powder that there was no light seen but what the fire of the volleys of shot gave."
In fact, this problem wouldn't be addressed until the introduction of smokeless powder in the late 19th century. A major advance in musket design came about with the invention of the flintlock, whereby a piece of flint stone rapidly struck the pan, causing sparks which ignited the powder. As the striking surface and the flash pan cover were one and the same, this simplicity allowed for more variety in the design of guns.
The problem with the matchlock was that you had to continually adjust the match because it was slowly burning away, which was quite inconvenient on a battlefield and almost impossible if you wanted to use a firearm on a horse. It wasn't until later self-contained ignition systems, such as the flintlock, came into use. Then you had a practical weapon for the infantryman and the cavalry. The flintlock would work in most weather conditions, which the matchlock wouldn't. So you could pull the trigger and it would be instantly operational.
Inevitably, there was a downside. Initially, the flintlock was slow firing, extremely inaccurate, and made it necessary to bring the musketeers up as close as possible to the enemy front line to be efficient. The muskets fired lead balls, and experienced soldiers could fire off 3 or 4 rounds per minute. But as the burnt black powder residue began to clog the barrel, this rate could quickly be reduced. However, increased reliability of the weapon also brought down the cost of deploying it in the field, making the flintlock the most popular ignition system in Europe, so successful that it reigned for 2 centuries virtually unaltered. During the 15th, 16th and 17th century, weapons could be classified in one of 2 groups. Shock weapons such as swords, spears, pikes and axes, which the infantry wielded in tight columns, and fire weapons such as longbows, crossbows, muskets and cannon, deployed in lines. In European armies, the standard infantry weapon was the long pike, which in the English army of the 16th century was 16 foot long. In the 17th century, however, more and more musketeers replaced pikemen as European infantry moved in general from shock weapons to fire weapons. This led to inevitable changes in the way battles were fought, with line formations necessarily replacing column formations. New drilling and maneuvering techniques were required to ensure that the action in the field could proceed without friction and chaos.
It's very difficult to arrange your ranks of musketeers so that one is firing while 2 are reloading. In the heat of battle, the rhythm gets disrupted. They've got to have a personal weapon to survive. And the personal weapon is, of course, the bayonet, which is a device, really, just to turn your musket into a pike.
The first bayonets appeared in France at a place reputedly Bayonne, and they were plug bayonets, and they were simply used for sporting use and were stuffed into the muzzle of the gun. And they were usually used when hunting boar. If one fired the gun and the boar was wounded or getting aggressive, you pushed your plug bayonet into the muzzle and then you could deal with him at arm's length. It came into the military much later, and it was often in the form of a bayonet fitting, as we now understand it. Bayonet fittings being the type you use on a light, you put it on and you twist it. And they were offset, so you could carry on loading the gun while with the bayonet attached. Whereas with a plug bayonet, it stopped you using the gun while the bayonet was in position.
The invention of the fixed bayonet meant that muskets now merged the effects of fire weapons and shock weapons, rendering pikemen obsolete. When the British Army's last pikes were finally phased out in 1705, the musket had finally taken pride of place in the front lines.
So she followed her redcoats, whatever they did, from the heights of Quebec to the plains of Versailles, from Gibraltar to Acre, Cape Town and Madrid, and nothing about her was changed on the way. But most of the empire which now we possess was won through those years by old-fashioned Brown Bess.
Praised by Rudyard Kipling in this poem, the most famous of the muzzle-loading muskets was undoubtedly the Brown Bess. The distinctive name has been retrospectively applied to a series of smoothbore flintlock muskets made between 1722 and 1830. The Brown Bess found an honoured place in British military folklore, even though the origins of the name are still wreathed in mystery, for it served to build and stabilise the British Empire.
An unrifled gun, handheld, muzzle-loaded, firing a projectile of some 0.7 of an inch in diameter. Not very accurate, but it had the ability en masse to stop advancing armies very easily and very effectively, but at, once again, limited short range.
The British Army acquired its first issue of Brown Bess muskets in 1715. Although nowhere near 100% accurate, their firepower and their ability to fire off 5 rounds a minute proved a very satisfactory compensation, especially as most firing was done within a distance of 100 yards.
A Brown Bess is a terrible weapon to be hit with. It's a lead ball weighing about an ounce, 3/4 of an inch diameter. Ballistically, it's as deadly on the human frame as a modern rifle, and we proved this with ballistic tests. It is very, very effective. The reason the Brown Bess wasn't very efficient is it was smoothbored and the ball was unlikely to hit anybody beyond about 50 or 60 yards.
This excerpt from the writings of a French officer in the Peninsular Wars graphically describes the deadly effectiveness that made the Brown Bess so popular.
The English remained quite silent with shouldered arms, and from their steadiness appeared to be a long red wall. At this moment of intense excitement, the English wall shouldered arms. An indescribable feeling would root many of our men to the spot. They began to fire. The enemy's steady, concentrated volleys swept our ranks. We turned round, seeking to recover our equilibrium. Then they were on us, pushing our disorganized flight.
Most military muskets were the same. The Brown Bess was a particularly heavy one. It had a slightly larger caliber than European muskets. But it was predominantly the same weapon. What was of advantage with the Brown Bess was the chap behind it. The British infantry were trained to fire faster than the enemy.
As the 19th century began, the musket too was on the threshold of a new era, a period in which a series of wars would propel it to the height of its fame. This was the Age of Waterloo, the Franco-Prussian War of 1871, Crimea in 1854, and of the Zulu and Boer Wars in Africa. As the century drew to a close, Brown Bess had served the soldiers well for over 100 years, but her reign was finally coming to an end.
It is simply the best development of the musket, and the musket can only be developed by radical changes to it in the matter of ignition or in the matter of rifling.
During the early unrest of the French Revolution, when no one could predict how the fighting might inflate, the British had begun to look once again at equipping troops with the best weapons available. In 1797, the British Army Board of Ordnance decided that rifled muskets were the way forward and ordered 5,000 from Prussia in 1798. The technique of rifling dates back to the days of the longbow, when Fletchers designed arrows to spin in flight to improve their accuracy. Hunting rifles had been manufactured with this facility since the beginning of the 18th century. Unfortunately, many of the German weapons were faulty on arrival, so a British solution to the problem was sought.
A committee of field officers was appointed for the purpose of examining and reporting according to their judgment. There were also many rifles from America and various parts of the continent produced at the same time. These were all tried at Woolwich. When my barrel, having only one quarter of a turn in the rifle, was approved by the committee.
In common with many continental weapons, gunsmith Ezekiel Baker's rifle had seven rectangular cut grooves. But his innovation was that the projectile turned only a quarter turn over the whole length of the barrel. This meant that many more shots could be fired between cleanings and greatly improved reliability with no discernible reduction of accuracy. It was sturdy, quick to reload, and, due to its short 32-inch barrel, could be reloaded lying down, a vital advantage that contributed to the changing tactics of 19th century warfare. The problem of weight was alleviated later by a slight reduction in the barrel length and a reduction in the bore to 0.653, which enabled it to use existing 0.615 cavalry carbine ammunition. A welcome side effect of the reduction in weight was the less violent recoil, which further improved accuracy. During the Peninsular Wars, these two improvements made the gun preeminent in sniper use.
It was designed to combat the growing use of skirmishers on European armies. As a European army advanced into action, it would send skirmishers ahead of it to cause trouble, to aggravate. And we had, the British had to introduce our own form of rifleman to combat that threat. So we adopted the Baker rifle. Because it was a rifled, patched ball gun, it had a range of perhaps 200, maybe 300 yards, far superior to the Brown Bess musket.
With its brass and English walnut furnishings, the Baker was a handsome design and very popular. Its other unique feature was the short sword it carried instead of a bayonet. This was side-mounted rather than socket-mounted, so that it didn't interfere with the sights and was longer, making sword and rifle the same length as the usual musket and bayonet combination. By the time of Waterloo in 1815, the Baker was firmly ensconced amongst the light regiments and was instrumental in the traumatic events that saw Wellington's men join the Prussians and Austrians to end Napoleon's dreams. It had the longest service life of any rifle ever used by the British Army. Throughout the 19th century, the pace of change in rifle technology increased dramatically. The next great evolution, though, was to come in bullet design.
In 1840, a French captain, Claude Etienne Minier, evolved a system of an expanding, elongated bullet. Now, this overcame the standard problem you had with all rifles, that's the difficulty of loading. A musket was easy to load because you simply rammed a naked lead patch ball down the barrel. A rifle was more difficult, more time-consuming to load because you had to ram a tight-fitting ball down the barrel. Now, with Minier's principle, he used an elongated bullet with an iron cup in a cavity in the base. This was small enough to go down the barrel without difficulty, so it could be loaded as quickly as a smoothbore. But the expanding gases when the powder ignited expanded the skirt of the bullet into the rifling, so it gripped the rifling.
And so you got a spinning effect. And so the Minier ball is spun by the rifling up the barrel.
The Minier rifle was adopted into the British service with the 1851 Minier pattern rifle. The first casualties of the Minier rifle were the cows on Plumstead Marsh. Some troops went out there to practice their target work, and they were used to the relatively short range of a smoothbore musket. And when they'd finished firing at the end of the day, cows in the distance had been shot, and they didn't realise the effective range of their guns.
Although the Minier design increased the range and accuracy of the rifle, there was still the time-consuming process of muzzle loading. The introduction of the breech-loading rifle overcame this barrier, and the rank-and-file soldier became increasingly deadly as weapons improved their accuracy. He could fire up to 15 rounds a minute and at much longer range.
The musket, even with the Minier ball, was good for three or four aimed shots a minute. with the integrated bullet lying down and using either putting bullets in at the top end or using the magazine, a trained soldier can get off 15 shots a minute. So you're getting a much greater volume of fire. This is much, much greater than the volume of fire of the American Civil War, and that, at perhaps 3 to 4 shots a minute, was devastating enough.
In turn, this forced a change in troop tactical deployment, as it became essential to use the battle area with more skill.
For the first time, it is no longer possible to fight your enemy standing up, shoulder to shoulder with your comrades, and engaging the enemy at a range of 10, 12, 50 yards or so. That kind of combat is now becoming extinct.
A whole plethora of new designs and improvements to rifles were introduced in the 19th century. From these emerged two names that were to become legends, synonymous with the last great struggles of the British Empire's waning star. The British introduced the Martini Henry in 1871, a breech loader with a falling block action. It was a combination of a loading mechanism by Friedrich von Martini and Alexander Henry's rifling. The Martini was soon to find immortality in another of Britain's colonial campaigns.
At this moment, the Zulu power is a menace to the peace of South Africa,
commented Sir T. Shepstone in 1878. The infamous Zulu Wars were about to begin.
We were armed with Martini Henry rifles charged with black powder, and each shot belched out a cloud of smoke. It became so dense that we were almost choked by it and simply fired blindly into it.
That was how Private George Mossop, who fought in the Zulu War of 1879, described the action. The Martini Henry used large, heavy .45 caliber bullets, causing terrible wounds to the Zulus at Rorke's Drift. A bullet fired from 200 yards would drive through two Zulus, one after the other.
The Martini Henry, a great departure from the Brown Bess, leagues away. It could be loaded from the breech with a cased cartridge, fired, had an accurate range beyond 250 yards. The actual projectile itself was built in the idea of a mini bullet that would expand to fit the rifle in and give or enhance the accuracy and the given range of that particular gun and cartridge.
During this colonial conflict, Isandlwana proved a turning point. Despite their superior weapons, 1,500 British were killed by the Zulu soldiers. The British learnt the lesson. By the 1880s, conspicuous red coats of the British had vanished to be replaced by khaki uniform, a sensible change, for the Zulu Wars fed into the Boer Wars and an entirely new kind of enemy and warfare. The heavy Martini Henry was being outclassed. A new weapon was needed. In 1884, the Germans had brought in the bolt-action Mauser. The age of the modern rifle had arrived.
You fire, open the bolt, close the bolt, fire, open the bolt, close the bolt, fire. You don't have to take a bullet from your bandolier and insert it each time.
Cordite now enabled a smaller weight of explosives to produce still greater firepower, which reduced ammunition size. As a bonus, the amount of smoke produced diminished. The higher burning temperature of cordite led to the army adopting the .303-inch Lee Metford rifle in 1888. Like the Mauser, it boasted an 8-round magazine and an essential increase in firing speed, gained by the bolt that was drawn back and then pushed forward to insert the cartridge.
It was noticeable during the Boer War that both sides using smokeless powder in the first major action in which it was used found difficulty in locating the enemy's shots simply because there wasn't the traditional puff of white powder smoke from the old black powder cartridges.
Just in time for the onset of the Boer War in 1899, another legend in rifle history was born. From the government factory in Enfield in England came the new Lee Enfield 303. The year was 1895. The rifle for the age of the most devastating battles in history had made its debut. In 1914, the British Army and the rifle were to face the most bitter challenge either had ever needed to face. As the soldiers crouched in trenches opposite the German forces in France, the rifle they held brought the entire initial German advance to a standstill. The Lee Enfield long magazine rifle was issued to the British troops who fought one of the first battles of the Great War at Mons in Belgium in August 1914. It was the fastest and the lightest of the World War I rifles due to its cock-on closing bolt action with rear-locking lugs and a detachable 10-round magazine. This magazine was twice the capacity of its rivals, and the experienced operator could fire between 12 and 15 well-aimed rounds per minute at targets 300 yards distant. Some men even achieved a rate of 30 rounds a minute.
It fired a bullet in around some 2,000 to 2,400 feet per second with an effective range out to and beyond some 2,000 yards. Every man that used it had no interest in using other captured firearms simply because what they was issued, they had a great deal of pride and a great deal of faith in that one gun. It could fire around almost every second if the shooter behind the gun was able to work the gun and keep it on aim sufficiently to do so. It had a number of given incidents, especially during the First World War, where the Germans actually thought they was under machine gun fire rather than just platoon rifle fire.
One British soldier who fought at Mons reported,
"For us, the battle took the form of well-ordered, rapid rifle fire at close range as the field grey human targets appeared or were struck down. The enemy infantry advanced in column of masses, which withered away under the galling fire. They crumpled up, mown down as quickly as I tell it, their reinforcing waves and sections coming on bravely and steadily to fall as they reached the first line of slain and wounded. Such tactics amazed us."
Now, you've got a position where the firing, if it's effective, is absolutely deadly. But it begins to produce another problem, which is that the infantryman only carries 60 or perhaps 100 bullets with him. He can fire that off in 10 or 15 minutes if he puts his mind to it.
There were minor deficiencies with the Lee Enfield. Firstly, although it was robust and well machined, its mechanism could be susceptible to dirt, which was not ideal on the Western Front. And secondly, because the .303 ammunition it fired was a rimmed round, the 10-round magazine and 5-round charger clips had to be refilled very carefully and laboriously, round by round, to avoid jamming. Overall, however, it was an excellent combat rifle, and modified versions of the Lee Enfield were still in service across the Commonwealth up until 1955.
It was the modern 20th century equivalent of the Brown Bess, simply because it was a very efficient, very good all-purpose rifle, which the ordinary infantryman could use and abuse, and it would continue to fire, and a sniper could use it as well.
The Germans' standard weapon was the Mauser Gerwaar 98, considered by many to be the best rifle of the war. Designed by Peter Paul Mauser in 1898, it was a 7.92mm caliber, centre-fire, two-lug action rifle with an internal 5-round magazine. The Mauser bolt action had been first introduced in the Mauser Commission Gerwaar model 1888 and was extremely reliable. It was to become one of the most copied designs of all time. The reliability and accuracy of the weapon meant that it was probably the best sniping weapon of the time when fitted with its optical sight. One of its advantages was also its only major drawback. In incorporating the clip and the magazine into one detachable mechanism, loading time was severely reduced, handicapped by the fact that it only held 5 rounds and had to be constantly reloaded during battle. It was not able to match the rapid-fire capabilities of the Lee Enfield. The Austro-Hungarians considered using the Mauser, but instead stuck to their own Steyr-Mannlicher Gerwaar M95. Which allegedly was so indestructible that it would still function after having fired 50,000 rounds with no lubrication of any kind. The French were less fortunate. standard issue was still the 8mm Le Bel Fusil d'Infanterie Modèle 1886-M93. Designed as far back as 1886 with an 8-round internal tubular magazine. It underwent minor modification in 1893 and over 4 million were produced in the period up to 1919. But the major design fault of the weapon was never solved. The design of the tubular magazine meant that when loading the weapon, the centerfire cartridges had to be pushed in nose to tail with nothing in between them. This was an accident waiting to happen if not done carefully, which was seldom possible under combat conditions. After numerous horrific accidents, the French began issuing the Berthier Fusil d'Infanterie Modèle 1907 Transformé in 1915, which was a distinct improvement on its predecessors because despite having only a 5-round clip, it was not prone to blowing up in your face and killing everyone in the vicinity during loading. The Model 1916 increased the magazine to a capacity of 6 bullets and was, unsurprisingly, exceedingly popular amongst French troops. As the war progressed, the nature of the fighting began to show that the rifle was losing the influence it once had in deciding the outcome of battle. It had triumphed at Ypres in 1914, but at the Somme-en-Verdun 2 years later, the artillery made pitilessly clear that it was now the dominating force. And the machine gun had also arrived to displace the rifle from its pride of place.
Generals in the First World War have got to figure in the effects of machine guns and artillery as well as the rifle. And they know still that battles are won not at long range, but by getting your troops to close with the enemy. And so their reaction to the technological changes is to say the answer is not in technology, the answer lies in morale. The answer lies in the determination of the soldier to cross the fire-swept zone and close with the enemy. While he's in the fire-swept zone, he's going to suffer terrible casualties. It's only as he closes with the enemy that those casualties are going to go down because the machine gun and artillery don't count anymore. It's down to the handheld weapon, and the handheld weapon is a one-shot affair.
However good the Mauser or Lee Enfield, the mountains of mud and shell-churned trenches meant accurate individual fire was all but impossible. Standard bolt-action rifles were proving too heavy and too slow for modern combat.
What did take place towards the end of the First World War was the Germans, when they were thinking about their stormtroopers for their big offensive of 1918, began to think in terms of a submachine gun for them, a light, very automatic weapon, which had very little range, but would spray bullets in a required area. The offensive took place really before they were able to develop it.
As for the Russians fighting in the east, if they were lucky enough to be issued with firearms at all, they carried the Mosin Nagant M1891 rifle. It was a centre-fire, bolt-action, 7.62mm rifle with a 5-round internal magazine. Over 9.3 million of them were produced in Russia and in France and America between 1891 and 1917. When the Americans finally entered the war in 1917, they arrived with the M1903A3 Springfield, caliber 30-03, based on the German Mauser. Once in combat, they found that they didn't have nearly enough and decided to find outside contractors to produce more Springfields. They approached the Winchester, Remington, and Edison arms companies about producing the weapon under license. As all three were already engaged in the production of the acclaimed Lee Enfield 303 for the British government, it was decided that the switch was unnecessary and that a simple recalibration of the weapon to 30-06 would see them fit for US Army use. The M1917 came into existence and ended up being the most widely produced and used rifle by the US military during the First World War. No one envisaged that in a future war with tanks and aircraft, the rifle would be able to play a major role in combat. 20 years later, they were to be proven catastrophically mistaken. The disaster at Dunkirk at the beginning of World War II left Britain seriously lacking rifles. so it was vital to produce one quickly and at low cost. In 1939, the Lee Enfield No. 4 Mark I had gone into production. Now the factories began to mass produce them in vast quantities. The problem with the rimfire ammunition was never addressed, but a receiver-mounted rear aperture sight had been added. The No. 4 Mark I also featured a heavy free-floating barrel which improved accuracy, a set-length numbered bolt head which made headspace adjustment easier, and a slightly shortened fore-end.
The idea of a free-floating barrel is to avoid contact along the underside of the barrel with the entire fore-end, because you cannot guarantee that you won't get different pressures on different parts of the barrel, which would set up vibrations or oscillations as the barrel was fired. So the idea is to prevent any interference between the barrel itself and all its oscillations, all its movements, and the rest of the gun.
The accuracy of the No. 4 Mark I was such that when fitted out with the x4 power sniper scope, it turned out to be the best sniping weapon of the war. In the hands of the Tommy, various types of Enfield saw action all over the world, from the snows of the Norwegian north to the hot sands of Africa in the struggle between Rommel and Montgomery. As in the First World War, the standard German infantry weapon in World War II was the five-shot, bolt-action Mauser 1898. The World War II version was called the Mauser Carabiniere 98K, which stood for Kurz, meaning short. It was highly accurate, reliable, and effective, and continued in production throughout the war.
There's only going to be one more significant development, which is a way of getting rid of this bolt action business and introducing a more automatic feed. And the ideas for this, of course, came from the machine gun, where Hiram Maxim had used the recoil effect of firing a bullet to produce a very fast firing weapon. And by the 1930s, it's become apparent that it would be desirable to convert or to have a modern rifle which had the same fast firing effect.
The British military always had this concern that if you provided a British soldier with a weapon that fired faster, it just gave you a problem of the supply of ammunition. No matter, you know, what the chap's got to do to defend himself, if you give him a gun that fires 600 rounds a minute, you've got the problem of supplying him with 600 rounds a minute. So we were never very forward in increasing the firepower of the infantrymen.
The Germans were more forward-thinking, and the Mauser 98Ks were supplemented by the development of successful automatic rifles. In trials in 1941, a Mauser design, which was subsequently named the Gewehr 41, beat a Walther entry and went into production for use on the Eastern Front. There it proved unreliable and was eventually replaced by the Model 43. By the middle of the war, the ways in which German soldiers used their weapons had changed. Russia, and especially Stalingrad, had taught them that only snipers needed accuracy at ranges over 1,000 yards. What was most urgently needed was the ability to lay down a lot of fire quickly at distances of up to about 400 yards. And to do this with any control required a lighter cartridge to reduce recoil. The MP40 submachine gun was in successful production. And when the MP43 submachine gun surfaced, Hitler, who did not understand the need for the new, less powerful weapon, rejected it. The arms minister, who understood only too well, managed to sneak it into production by changing its name to machine pistol. When Hitler began receiving glowing reports about the new weapon, his initial fury abated, and he himself named the weapon Sturmgewehr, coining the term assault rifle.
While we were maintaining single-shot magazine-fed bolt-action rifles, the Germans were producing submachine guns that could be carried by an individual firing sub-caliber ammunition, pistol ammunition. and issuing more and more machine guns, light machine guns to troops.
The Soviets had spent the interwar years working to develop their own semi-automatic rifles. The first to be issued to parts of the Red Army was the Simonov AVS, which was deemed too complicated and was replaced in 1938 by the first of the Tokarev-designed automatic rifles, the SVT-38. This was a 7.62mm rifle with a 10-round detachable box magazine and a 24.02-inch barrel with a four-turn rifling. It had advantages over the Simonov in terms of simplicity, but it was also slightly quirky, with features such as an externally mounted cleaning rod, and as a result, it proved fragile. A more traditional and robust version of the SVT-40 was introduced 2 years later. On this weapon, the cleaning rod was mounted sensibly under the barrel. There was only a single barrel band, beyond which a sheet metal wraparound handguard had replaced the metal wood guard of the SVT-38.
By the time it went to issue, it was in very, very limited numbers towards the end of the war, but it went on to produce some 4.5 million almost of these guns, and they was in wide use leading right up until the Vietnam era. They work very well, although the rifle itself is very long for a semi-automatic assault gun and somewhat clumsy in built-up areas. It works in very harsh conditions, and it's for the most part everything that an infantryman would want given the conditions it has to fight under.
Some SVT-40s were issued with telescopic sights and issued to snipers, but most snipers used the Mosin-Nagant bolt-action rifle. When fitted with a telescopic sight, the Mosin-Nagant was a deadly sniper weapon. By the time the Americans entered the Second World War in 1941-42, they had had a long time to prepare. The M1 Garand self-loading service rifle had been in development since 1929 and was the standard infantry rifle of the US Army in the Second World War.
John Garand had attracted attention because he was an engineer in the US Army, and he had made a design of a new machine gun for the US Army, which they had not adopted, but they had noted him as a good man. And so he began work for the Army in the 20s and 30s, and his work produced the Garand.
The Garand was the first practical self-loading rifle. It was semi-automatic, it wasn't fully automatic, 30 caliber, very, very useful, quite ahead of its day.
The bullet reached a speed of 2,760 feet per second and was accurate to a range of 5,500 yards. More than 4 million M1 Garands and M1 Carbines were produced before the end of World War II.
It was a limited magazine capacity, it only carried about 8 rounds. So although it could fire as fast as you could pull the trigger, you were limited to how many shots you could fire before you had to stop and reload, and that was the only real disadvantage. Otherwise, it was an excellent weapon, and it was well proved, and the fact it was produced in such great numbers shows how highly regarded it was.
Finally, mention should be made of the British L1A1 self-loading rifle, or SLR. It evolved from the 7.62mm FAL, developed by the Belgian company Fabrique Nationale in the early 1950s and remained in use until the middle of the 1980s.
When the rest of the world had gone to automatic weapons, we were just changing to the self-loading rifle, which was a semi-automatic weapon that only fired every time you pulled the trigger.
I think personally that the British Army, or the people that procure such weaponry for the British Army, were still quite reticent, and they was against going for fully automatic firepower and the need for such firepower. At platoon level, the British Army actually carried light machine guns and other weaponry that would take the part of that and still reinforce platoon strength firepower. The need for individual fully automatic firepower was not really needed.
Whatever reason, we stayed with the SLR for so long when all the world's armies were further advanced in fully automatic weapons, is simply the tradition of the British Army, the British services, in weighing up all the aspects of the infantry's life, not just giving him the best weapon that would fire the quickest, but giving him a weapon that he would use sensibly. He wouldn't expend ammunition unnecessarily. And for most infantrymen, the times you need to fire fully automatic are relatively few.
The importance and respect that any soldier has for the rifle that they are first issued with and must use to fight with is perhaps best summed up by the US Marines Rifleman's Creed.
This is my rifle. There are many like it, but this one is mine. It is my life. I must master it as I must master my life. Without me, my rifle is useless. Without my rifle, I am useless. I must fire my rifle true. I must shoot straighter than the enemy who is trying to kill me. My rifle and I know that what counts in war is not the rounds we fire, the noise of our burst, or the smoke we make. We know that it is the hits that count. We will hit. My rifle is human even as I am human, because it is my life. Thus, I will learn it as a brother. I will learn its weaknesses, its strengths, its parts, its accessories, its sights, and its barrel. I will keep my rifle clean and ready, even as I am clean and ready. We will become part of each other.
It may be that future advances in rifle technology will not produce the great leaps of innovation that were part of its development in the past. But with wars continuing to blight the world, and the infantry soldier still an integral part of battle planning, despite the advent of intelligent bombs, the rifle is as essential to the modern soldier as it has always been. Inseparable from his past, indispensable for his future.